Chapter 2, The Return Customer. Daniel returned to the shop the very next day. He couldn't help himself. On reflection, he felt silly for rushing out in such a panic. Now he'd had time to think, he supposed what he'd seen must have been a clever trick, an illusion, nothing more. But he found himself desperate to know exactly how the owner of the shop had made the magpie seem so real. He spent breakfast trying not to look at Spud Harper, who made threatening gestures at him across the dining hall for the entire meal. Slipping out during the rush after breakfast was easy. Lost in the flow of the crowd, Daniel darted along to the kitchens, where the back door was always open to let out the reek of the chef's cooking. The world was bathed in Sunday sunshine, the sky endless blue. Daniel retraced his steps from the previous trip, passing the butcher's shop, breathing the smell of sawdust and raw flesh, and found himself back in the gargoyle-lined street. For a moment, he was worried that he'd dreamt the whole thing. But then he saw black bricks glistening in the light of the sun and a grand archway door and golden sign, the Nowhere Emporium. The closed sign was still displayed in the door. Daniel stared at it, arguing with himself, knowing that he shouldn't try to enter. But something about the shop was pulling him in. His hands trembled as he reached for the handle. The door was not locked. He pulled it open and felt warmth spilling from the shop. Inside, it was exactly as he'd left it. There was no sign of the owner, no hint of the silver birds. Daniel examined the column of books where the magpies had landed. Then, treading softly, he made his way towards the red velvet curtain to the spot on the floor where the birds had fallen and smashed into rubies. The light in the place was dim. He had to drop to his knees to inspect the floor. Not a single ruby anywhere. The velvet curtains flapped, and Daniel found himself staring at a pair of grey leather shoes. He looked up into eyes the colour of angry thunderclouds, eyes that did not leave him, not even for the briefest moment. Silence. The shop owner's brow furrowed. He rubbed at his temples. He opened and closed his mouth several times, but no words escaped. He blinked, turned around, and retreated through the curtain. Then he poked his head back into the shop, as if checking to see if Daniel really was there. Eventually, he burst through the curtain and stood inches from Daniel, stooped over so that they were eye to eye. He smelled like the pages of old books. "How can I help you?" he said. His voice was calm, but the look in his eyes suggested that a storm was erupting somewhere in his brain. Daniel said, "I just wanted another look around. Is that okay?" The man craned his neck so that his face was even closer to Daniel's. He narrowed his eyes and whispered, "You remember this place?" "Yeah, I was only here yesterday." The man grabbed him by the wrist and rushed him over to the desk. "Have a seat," he said, pushing Daniel onto a wooden chair, sitting himself on his desk. He pressed the palms of his hands together. "What do you remember?" he said. "Tell me exactly." I remember everything. The books and the mirrors and the clocks. Meeting you. The silver magpies." The man held up a finger to quiet Daniel. His eyes were darting about the place. How is this possible?" he said. "I'm sorry," said Daniel in confusion. "Have I missed something? How is what possible?" The man leapt to his feet. "Which children's home are you from?" he asked. "St. Catherine," said Daniel. "It's only a few streets away." The man nodded. "Have you ever noticed strange things happening around you? Lights flickering, mirrors smashing, that sort of thing?" "No. Why?" "No reason," said the man with a casual wave of his hand. Then he grabbed Daniel and pulled him from the chair, ushering him towards the door. "Listen, Daniel Holmes, we're closed, as the sign on the door so clearly states, so I think you should be toddling off home." "But..." And with that, Daniel was pushed out into the street, completely stunned by what had just happened. On the other side of the glass, the owner stared at him for a moment, and when Daniel blinked, he was gone. Daniel began to trudge back down the street, hands in pockets, aiming kicks at the occasional stone. If he had looked around at the correct moment, he might have noticed the door of the Nowhere Emporium opening a fraction and an ashen hand tossing two silver birds into the air. He might also have noticed that these birds flew from rooftop to rooftop, perching on stone angels, watching his every step as he made his way back to St. Catherine's.